So, good morning everybody. This is Dr. Luis Vasquez from Herbal. We have a very distinguished guest today. So, please tell us your name and a little bit of your background.
Sure. Hi everyone. My name is Eric Edmadi. I'm a health coach and I'm from the United States and most recently California, San Francisco. And I love natural health. I've studied through a program out of New York, and I haven't always been into a health or a health coach. I have an engineering background, and I went to the University of Florida to study that.
I have one question because we are broadcasting or recording, whatever you name it, in Guadalajara, Mexico.
Yes.
What are you doing in Mexico?
Well, you know, about 5 months ago, you know, the world changed. We had some dynamics going on, as you know.
Yes.
And I had intended to leave, and I had misread some news, actually. I misread some news about all of the dynamics. They started doing aggressive shutdowns and closing businesses. So I misread the newspapers that they were shutting this, but not shutting that. So I figured, well, maybe it's a good time to take a break. And I left and I got here. I got to Mexico City. I said, oh, everything wasn't closed, but I'm already here. You know, I had a friend kind of take care of my stuff. And I've decided to stick around for a little while. And this is the fourth city. I've been to four cities so far, and this is the one I like the best.
Really?
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
I have a question. I mean, why are you into the health lifestyle? And I mean, why are you interested in these topics?
Yeah. Thank you. Very good question. Yeah. I always wonder myself, really. No, I'm just kidding. Well, I think it was a couple of factors. You know, growing up in Florida. Now, Florida, I'm from South Florida, where there's a lot of, in the U.S., there's a dynamic where people would move. The elderly is a nice way to say it. Older people, elderly, los viejos, whatever you want to say, would move from the north part of the United States to Florida. You know, they moved from New York. And a lot of older people there, and my grandparents were there, and a lot of them, I see a lot of them have health issues. They have this device to walk, you know, they walker, you know, they...
Like a stick?
That would be like a cane. A walker is like a...
Oops,
aluminum.
Okay.
Maybe it has like four legs.
Oh, yes.
And it's light. We call it a walker. They move it, and then they take a step, and then they move it, and they take a step. It's, well, these old people look like they're about to fall over. And my grandmother, unfortunately, she had a hip replacement, and she was always having a lot of problems with it. It would pop out, whatever they did, they didn't, I guess, she had many problems. After seeing a lot of health issues in the family, and luckily a neighbor was into natural medicine. She was only two doors over, and I was very thankful. I would go over, and she'd hear me, you know, she'd hear me scratchy throat or a cough, and she'd be very curious, hey, what's going on here? And I said, oh, I just have a cold, and she's like, hold on a second. She'd open this cabinet, and be like, your office with all these herbs and Chinese, and I didn't know what they were, and she's like, okay, take this one, and take this one, and take this at night, and two of these in the morning, and take it for 4 days, and bring me back the bottles when you're done. So she'd lend me the bottles, and I'd take them, and I think in this exposure, you know, I thought this is so interesting, you know, everybody's, I didn't know much about it, but it seemed to plant the seed, you know, the idea of like,
yes,
yeah.
It's the same phrase in Spanish.
Oh, neat.
Actually,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, cool. So yeah, then it just seemed interesting, and when I went away to university, 5 hours north, there were some pockets, we would say, some areas where people were into kind of hippie a little bit, but they were always talking about some herbs or some way to eat, and the Hare Krishnas were there. Every day they'd bring food for the students, and they'd ask just for small donations. Oh, this is so interesting, you know. And then I just kind of felt, and then after I studied engineering, I actually worked in technology for many years, and I said, I really like this. I like learning about like vitamin C, and I read books about like detox, and I'm like, wow, you know, engineering, like to make a bridge or a computer, like, well, we're walking around with an engineered device. The body's like an engineered machine, a fleshy machine. That's like, I just think it's so fascinating.
Oh, please share with us what books did you read? Please tell us one or two.
Oh, okay, sure. Yeah, I'd be happy to. Now, in school, they had like a little pile of lists. But the first one, I think the most significant one that really opened my eyes and really made me interested was a actual medical doctor in the U.S. lives around Arizona. He went to Harvard, and he's from the 60s. His name is Dr. Andrew Weil, W-E-I-L.
You know what? I know him.
Yeah?
Yes.
He has a big beard. He looks like
Santa
Claus. Yes. He got a big beard and a big belly.
Yes.
And he was on...
Weil.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, we say Weil, but I'm sure.
Yeah, sorry, it's Weil.
Yeah, I'm sure that's how you pronounce it.
And I immediately think about the German pronunciation.
Yeah. I can imagine, yeah.
Okay.
So he had a book, he had a few books. One was called Spontaneous Healing. Wow, it was just like amazing story. I'm like, oh, every, you know, every time I read it, I'm like, wow, someone, you know. The theme was like, people were really sick, and then they think, well, all right, I have X amount of time to live, you know, and then they either by accident, or somebody recommends, hey, why don't you see my friend? They're a chiropractor, an acupuncturist, they're a reflexologist, they do a meridian or something unusual, and then
yes.
they get better, and then you know, then they go back to the doctor. The doctor would say, oh, well, there must be we must have made a mistake with our diagnosis. Or something very kind of dismissive, you know, they'd be so excited. Doc, I fixed this, I healed my condition, you know, isn't it amazing? And then sometimes it'd be a little, yeah, that's great, and they wouldn't be so receptive, or they would have some story like, yeah, spontaneous remission, I think that's like a term in the US.
There is always an euphemism in
yes.
the medical terminology for everything.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I know that very well.
Yeah.
So, Andrew Weil.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
And we have it's one of the books I can't think of right now, but we have a TV show, a TV station in the US. It's called PBS, which is Public Broadcasting System. So it's a usually educational channel. It's not like sports or news. It's a channel where maybe four times a year they say, listen, you know, nobody pays for us, but you guys, so we'll say, please call in, give us $1, $5, $10, $20, $50. And so they always ask for donations. So it's a very, I think it's like an honorable station. And they always have something interesting. And he used to be on there a lot.
It's like a patron, you mean?
Oh, yeah, kind of before the patron.
Oh, yeah, yes, okay.
That model, but they have also in the radio station too, so there's no video, but this was a station where they'd have like symphony music, you know, very slightly sophisticated, or you know, a little bit, wouldn't have like wrestling or boxing. It'd always be like something educational for, and he was on there a lot. I said, well, who is this guy, you know? And I thought it was so interesting. I would just go read his books. And then that's one. There's so many. There's also a guy I mentioned earlier before we started recording was Dr. Group, Dr. Edward Group III.
Okay.
He has a clinic in Houston. And he has a book. It has the detox diet, or I don't remember the exact name, but it's a detox something. It's probably the only book by him. And he's a really neat guy. I admire a lot. I just saw an interview with him. How his family was like, someone in his family helped write the U.S. Constitution, and yeah, he's got quite an interesting history. Very high prominent figures in his family.
One of the founding fathers of the U.S.
That's what he admitted. Yeah, and I heard a story. He was going to go become an MD in the army, and someone told him about natural medicine, and he was very against it. He was arguing, and then you know he says, "Oh wait, maybe this is a good idea." And he's a naturopath and a doctor of chiropractor, and he has some other four or five letter acronyms. I don't even know what they are, to be honest. But he's a real neat guy, from what I can tell. So all of his stuff, and he has a clinic similar to yours in Houston, Texas, and he has that southern accent a little bit. those are two. And then I mentioned the dental diet. I'm reading that right now. Those are the ones I can think of right now.
As a matter of fact, my grandmother was from Texas.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, cool. Do you know what part?
San Antonio.
San Antonio. Yeah. Have you been there? Did you?
Yes, I have been there a number of times. Like, I don't know, plenty of times. By the way.
Cool. Did you met your grandmother?
I met her, but unfortunately, she passed away when I was, I don't know, 16 or 17.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
But doesn't matter.
Oh, we'll get to see her. That's good.
Yeah, I have a lot of questions
to
you.
Sure. Happy to answer.
Well, I want to ask you, for instance, in your estimation, what's the best diet for humans?
Yeah, it's a good question. Now, that's actually a central part of my schooling, because my school is a neat guy. It was a guy from New York who has a background in macrobiotics. Are you familiar with that?
Yes, a little bit.
Should we explain for the audience?
Yes, please.
Okay, a brief explanation of one of the many types of diets. Macrobiotics, and I'm not an expert, but from what I understand, it's a Japanese diet based on, I forgot the guy who started it, but it's a type of eating, I think it's mostly, if not fully vegetarian, where you eat certain categories of food, and basically this is what this guy studied, and he said, wow, this is so interesting, but then he's, and it's almost like he believed that's the way, like when you study something, at least he felt, when you learn macrobiotics as a way to eat, it's like a soup, like miso soup, would be maybe some fermented Japanese vegetables, daikon radish, special kind of seaweed, it had some sea vegetables, some things that were very healthy that were available in Japan. So he had kind of what we could say an epiphany. He said, well, I think this is the best way to eat. I was trained, but other people are getting healthy eating a different kind of diet. Maybe, you know, not macrobiotic, maybe some kind of vegan, or vegetarian, or maybe a Native American diet or a European diet. Well, how come they're getting healthy with that? And he started wondering, so he started researching, and he found 120 types of diets around the world. And some of it is regional, like if you grow in an area, like if you're Native American, you may have, and you're near like a, what they call a blubber community, they may eat, actually catch whale, and eat whale blubber, mostly, because that's pretty much all they have. They're in the Alaska, they don't have access to, it's snowing all year round, they're not growing, you know, wonderful papayas and
mangoes.
No, so he said, wow, so fascinating that he didn't understand at the time how you could eat a different diet and still be very healthy. So we studied like 120 types of diets, and he made up an interesting term called bio-individuality. So it's basically, it depends on, like, let's say you want to eat a raw vegan diet, but all your friends, you don't have any friends now, so you're going to eat the food. But he says also your social life and your state of mind is, in quotes, kind of like food. So if you eat the greatest food, but you're depressed, and you don't have any friends, that's not good. So you have to have the right combination of emotional and the actual food and what's available. So it's really, I'm sorry I can't give you a direct answer, but it really depends. It really depends on the right environment. Like if you're, especially if you're in a relationship, if you want to eat one type of diet and your significant other wants to eat another type of diet, you might have a, you know, a different, you might not be able to have meals together. Or you want to eat two times a day and they want to eat three times a day, you know?
Yes.
So it really depends on enough factors. I think to get closer to an answer would be that you would eat things that are healthy, which we can discuss, of course, like clean food. I kind of like to think of like a do and a don't. Like, do eat food that was grown in good soil. Definitely eat food that was grown. I mean, many people don't, you know, not in a box. There's actually another guy, Michael Pollan. He's from the University of California, Berkeley. Michael Pollan? Pollan or Pollan? I think it's Pollan. He has a saying, he wrote some books, and he says,
Michael?
Michael, yes.
Michael.
Yes.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Maybe Miguel in Spanish.
Pauline, P-A-U-L-I-N?
I believe it's P-O-L-L-A-N. Okay. In Spanish.
Okay.
So he has a few books. The Omnivore's Dilemma, I haven't read it, but he says, he has a saying, he says, eat food, not too much, mostly plants.
Okay.
You know, you can go with that. So actually there's a chain of restaurants in the United States, a small chain, there's only a few of them, and I think it's called Tender Greens, and they make a diet menu on his concept. Like you walk in, you have these wonderful cooked greens. In the US we have collard greens. Have you heard of collard greens?
Collard greens?
Yeah. A green would be like a lettuce, but you would a thick lettuce that you would cook. Kale?
Oh yes, I understand. Yeah.
So the cousin or a relative to kale would be a collard, you know, like a collar.
Yes, yes.
It actually, on the green, if you can imagine a green leaf, there's a little ring, and the ring looks like a collar, so they call it a collard, as an adjective, a collard green.
Like that color, like Audrey's color?
Yes, yes, yes. I thought you were looking at it, you had a green
leaf I could look at. Maybe we'll find some afterward on an image site.
It's a thick green leaf that you cook in the U.S. It's common in what we call the south part of the United States, so like Texas all the way as you go east.
I know, Louisiana.
Usually have bacon, so it's, but you can make it vegan. So they walk in and you have all these cooked, we would use the word hearty, you use it in Spanish too, a hearty vegetable, like a lot of, like, you know, it's just something like, you take a bite and like, wow, that's amazing. Hearty is a word, but I'm sorry, I got off track. What were you asking? like talking to Michael Pollan, you asked about books and
No.
Best diet for humans. I'm back. Okay, I'm back. So the best diet, it really depends. So it would be, you know, a fair amount of cooked, not necessarily cooked, but grown food. You know, maybe a small amount of grains. You know, and. But I would say, depending on your physique and your condition, you know, some people, you know, another side note is we have a lot of organisms I've learned growing in us. There's a more.
You mean bacteria?
One of them.
Fungus.
Yeah.
So viruses as well. Sometimes.
Yes. Yes. There's other categories of like a ringworm is a. Parasites is another.
Also
parasites.
Parasites, yes.
Yeah.
So and we need them,
exactly.
As a matter of fact.
Yeah. I learned that even though there's, if you had to put them all out, all the DNA of all of them to all of our DNA, there's more of their DNA than our DNA. Yes. Yeah. Now, if you put them all in a bag, it would be like this much of a, we use gallon bag, a gallon bag.
I understand. Yeah. Yes, it's like 5 liters or so, a gallon.
I think it's 4.9.
Something, liters.
Yeah, something like that. I forget the conversion, but if you could take all of the, they're really foreign, they're really not us, but they're in us, in our cells, in our organs, and if you could take them all out, they would take about this much space. And like, for example, you know probably better than I do, like the Candida family, they will thrive off the sugar, so you definitely want to have a lower sugar diet, maybe completely avoidance. So
definitely.
Before to say, yeah, it's really on your like your bioidentical, like a fingerprint. You have to really know what's going on before you say this is the best diet, because some people may have a sugar sensitivity or a genetic predisposition or something. So you really, you know, really gotta. So you can say in general, just clean food. But then it depends, you have to dig a little deeper and have that conversation. maybe some studies and reports, you know, maybe some conventional tests, and maybe some more, I would say progressive tests. There's some places you can only get certain tests, like some people I study, they only have tests in Canada and here in Mexico. Beyond blood, you have to get some kind of...
To culture it, so you can grow. Yes, I know. I know what you are talking about. Yeah,
yeah. You got to know what's going on, basically. Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, you have to know if you're low in. Like I also do. I've recently learned from another a colleague, she went to my school, and she has a wonderful podcast and website. She does, they take in the US, are you familiar with Hair Test Mineral Analysis?
Hair Test Mineral? No.
Yeah, oh, it's really interesting. So it's always kind of hard. Maybe one day we'll have a magic machine, it's just like in Star Trek. It is, oh, you're low in sodium, and you're high in magnesium, and you have too much mercury.
There's a clinic in South Germany that does that with the color of the elements.
Oh, really?
I know, Michael Riet, that's the name of the clinic.
But how do they test? Do they take some of your fingernail? You need something from the body, like blood.
Blood.
Or,
they need blood.
Or spit, saliva.
Yeah.
The urine. So this is a test with hair. It takes some hair. And we take, an agreement. I'm a practitioner now. I was my own patient and my father, only two so far. But you take some hair, and they have a machine for geology, when they study rock.
Yes, yes.
Minerals. Parts per billion. They can, and they use it for hair, and they explain the body will excrete to give you a hint. If you have too much mercury, which it will excrete about 20 different, both harmful and helpful minerals and things like minerals, and then they can give you a chart and say, well, this represents the similar, not exactly, because it's excreting. If it can, the body can't, if you have mercury, it sometimes can excrete it, so the test can tell you, oh yeah, see, it came in your hair because you have it in your body. Sometimes it's too, like, sequestered, you know the word sequestered?
Yes, yes.
It's
very
too
well.
Trapped in the body, so
mm-hmm. Yes.
You need to start cleansing before it can release it, and you have to, so this is one test I know of to get a indication of the status of the body. Yeah, I'll show you more after.
Yes,
I'm with two different companies, actually. They are the best, as far as I know, the best in the country, if not the world, for a type of hair. They call it for HTMA, Hair Test Mineral Analysis. I have it on my website. If I can show my website.
Oh, yes. Could you share with us your
Thank
website?
You. Yes, yes.
I'm going to write it down somewhere. You know what? I should write it down the entire video. Your website.
Oh, no. Thank you.
Yes.
In the description, however, but thank you. Yeah.
Some of them are just watching jokes on YouTube or
cats.
Wasting their time. It would be better if they listen to you and your website.
Well, cat videos are very important too, you know.
You think so?
Okay, let's say, they say laughter is the best medicine. It's
well, yeah. No, time. Isn't it? No, I thought it was time the best
well,
medicine.
Well, time heals all wounds.
You're right.
But maybe I have it wrong. I don't know. I don't know. They go together. Time and laughter. But yeah, on my website, nutritionbyeric.com, and it's Eric with a C, because I know here it's like it's CK sometimes. But on my website, I have some information about that. And devices, there's wonderful devices you can actually pull toxins out of your body. I have some on my blog as well. The ionic foot bath is kind of an interesting one.
Yeah. That leads me to another question. What's your take in regards to poultry, meat, fish, and so on?
Yeah, I know it's a touchy. I know you're a vegetarian.
Yes,
I
am.
Without offending.
I had to ask you
that. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, well, you know, back to my schooling, you know, my founder, being macrobiotic, I think he was vegetarian for many years, and then I think maybe that's what it got his curiosity. People are eating meat and they're getting better. So, you know, I enjoy all, you could say, natural medicines, and there's so many. I mean,
yes.
Yeah, you have, we have the Chinese, they have the TCM.
TCM?
Yeah, it's an acronym for traditional Chinese medicine. And a lot of times, you know, they talk about this thing, the five elements, which are somehow it ties in. I'm not an expert, but they like earth, the element of earth, the element of air, of fire, of wood, and metal. Somehow, like, everything is made of those. Like, you know, metal isn't, like, metal has a kind of dynamic, a quality, I guess maybe it's the word quality. So, back to the question about meat, I think, you know, meat in Chinese medicine, they say meat can be very helpful because the dynamics, there's a bioenergetic, or what's a nice way to say, there's a certain quality you get from meat. There's, it's very concentrated in certain, you know, minerals, and you can get a lot of nutrient. Not to say you can't get the same nutrient profile from plants and vegetables, you know, from vegetables and fruits and things, but there's some nutritional value from livestock. You know, you can break that up into whether you want to say the fish, you know, if you're a fish or poultry or the larger animals, but yeah, they say you can get a lot of health benefits. One dentist traveled the world, and he found the healthiest people would hunt because they were in they didn't have any education. They would live in live in the woods.
In the woods, or
yeah,
yes,
in the woods. So they would just go and they'd hunt an animal, and they would eat everything at all. You know, all the organs and everything. And then the Chinese say, you know, the heart, every animal's organ can be beneficial to a human. So if you have a heart problem, for example, you could eat theoretically the heart of an animal. But that's what makes nutrition so interesting. That's just one way. It doesn't mean it's the only way, but the energetics, you know, of course we all need, we say that in the US, people who go to the gym and look at their diet, they say, I want to know my macros. Do you know that word?
Macronutrients?
Yeah, it's kind of an abbreviation.
Lipids and carbs and proteins and so on?
Yeah, those are the main ones. So especially if you're going to the gym, most people want the protein. And of course, animals definitely, you know,
have protein.
Yeah, that's just how it is. So,
Well, despite the fact that I am a vegetarian and I recommend my patients to go plant-based, well, of course, meat has a certain number of nutrients. I agree with that. But I have one question.
Yeah.
Don't you think that in that case, the meat should be eaten raw so you can absorb all the nutrients and so on?
That's a great question.
That's what I tell my patients. Okay, you want to eat meat? Okay, eat the meat raw. And they say, no, what? Are you F-U-C-K-I-N-G kidding me?
Oh, my virgin ears.
We swear a lot here in Mexico.
Okay.
That's part of our culture. We love it.
But
I don't want to be offensive to the English-speaking community. I don't know if the...
I'm sure they've heard it.
If Puritans are going to be offended.
Yeah. We'll get banned from YouTube. YouTube police.
You think... No.
I'm just kidding.
Bill Maher swears a lot.
Who?
Bill Maher.
Oh, yeah. Bill Maher, yeah. Gosh,
this guy swears a lot all the time.
Yeah. I'm sure. No, I'm kidding. I agree. Now, to that point, though, back to the raw. Now, the concern, though, is now we didn't really talk about in the U.S. we have factory farming. I'm sure other countries too. I don't know how it is here, but you're familiar with the term factory farming?
No.
Okay, maybe a quick
explanation. Yes, please.
So when you're going to if I grew up in the U.S., so of course I'm most familiar with that. Most people get their meat from a grocery store, supermarket, and they just, you know, see the container, you know, you can go right to the, it's not really a butcher, but the meat area, and you can just point it out and cut it for you, or you just usually get it in a styrofoam rectangle with like a little diaper underneath it and some plastic wrap, and you just, most people don't realize how did that get there? So this is a big issue. This is why I like Weston Price, someone I alluded to earlier. He was a dentist who traveled the world and found the healthiest people. Said, well, you know, you can, if you're in a farm or you're in the woods and you have an animal growing and they're eating the, say for a cow, he's eating the fresh grass, then that's one situation. But what's happened over many decades, I'm talking 40, 50, 60 plus years, there's the unfortunate attraction and interest to make things earn money. If you have a big space for cows,
yes,
you gotta go get the cow and bring them into the, you know, to the place where they unfortunately kill the cow. It's a big mess. So what they do is they have like a big warehouse, and they have the cows in a space, you know, you can watch videos on it. It's not very exciting. Basically, there's a lot of cows, like in this little space, just big, almost big enough, and pigs and chickens and all that. And then they're like a little machine, you know. And they're given one thing. So you think of all the factors. They don't have the space, and they're usually given shots because they're so close together. Maybe the stress, and the food isn't the best. Naturally, they would eat grass.
Yes.
But in the lot, it's cheaper to give them corn. Yeah. And it's just whatever cheap grain. And also, grass has to be fresh grain. So they just, you know, like if you ever see dog food, it's not a fresh product. It's dry like a pellet. So they feed them. There's so many, right? Basically, this is just some examples. It's much more to it than this. Like sometimes they start with grass and then they, at the end, give them corn because the corn will make them a little bit bigger for some reason. And then there's a lot of, I guess you could say, alteration.
Yes.
Alteration in many areas. What they eat is altered. How much space?
They also have antibiotics in their food, and that's not healthy.
Yes.
And in my estimation, that's the main reason why there is so much resistance to antibiotics.
I agree. I completely agree.
It makes my life a hell when I'm treating patients with infections.
Yeah, it reminds me of us, back to books for a quick moment, is there was a beef rancher, with someone who grows up with cows, and they're on like a ranch in Texas or somewhere. A beef rancher, and I think he's wrote a book called, I think it was called Mad Cowboy, because you know Mad Cow Disease?
Yes, I know. Creutzfeldt Jakob Disease, yeah.
Oh, Mad Cow Disease.
The name is...
The proper name.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, no, that's good to know, yeah. So Mad Cowboy, so it was about a rancher who got really sick, and he said, I think it's from these chemicals they're giving me to spray, because it's a whole other situation. And he goes, I'm pretty sure it's these chemicals. So he grew up as a rancher, means he grew up with cattle, and he was always eating steak, and he almost died, and they had to do a surgery. And they had to cut a nerve. And they said the doctor wasn't sure which was the right nerve, and he had to guess. It's like in the movie, where they defuse the bomb, and you have like... three wires. Which one is one wire turns it off. Which one?
White. Another green. Yellow.
Okay. Definitely, it's gonna blow up if they make this up. So he was like, okay, I almost died. This is crazy. So he became like turned his life, you could say, 180. He was an Oprah. It was a big mess because he was an Oprah and got in a lot of trouble for what he said and what Oprah said on Oprah. So he became a vegetarian or vegan. That's why you might like the book especially. But yeah, if you're going to eat meat, you know, because, you know, eating it raw. Now, if it's a pure, clean environment, or even if it's not a pure, clean environment, with the crowding and the antibiotics and the non-natural food and GMOs, and they're standing in their own feces most of the time, and it's dirty and it's stressed, and there's even more stuff I can think of that they do to them. But... a lot of times they will get worms in their flesh. So if you eat raw meat, you have an increased possibility of having worms.
Yes, everything I can learn is fantastic.
Yeah, we know you're a smart guy, so you're picking up a lot. I'm learning too from you, so that's cool.
This chair is so strange. Okay. Oh, sorry, you were saying or that
yeah, so just back to me being, I know you asked about eating raw, so that's one case against it. I mean, yeah, another book is a little, I think it's called Cure Dental Disease by Ramil Nagel. It's a wonderful little book, really thin, but man, it's brilliant. Brilliant, based on the work of Weston Price, and he talks about if you can do raw meat with a raw egg. But of course, you want to make it the highest quality you can, so there's no risk of disease, or you know, you can have a pathogen, is another word, right?
Yes.
In raw. So where were we? We're talking about if you're into meat, you have to know the quality of the meat, and plus your digestion. There's so many. I was thinking, I stepped away for a sec. The concept of amino acids. That's one thing that's also present in meat, which if you're going to get it from plant sources, B12 especially notoriously is a difficult one to get unless you get it through fermented
nutritional yeast or something like that.
From bacteria.
Bacteria, yeah.
Because that bacteria is what produces B12, not meat. A lot of people keep telling me, you should eat meat because within the meat is B12. No, yeah. It's because bacteria produces the B12.
Yeah. Yeah, and in fact, you know, so it just depends, you know, it's amazing if you think of nature, like, nature doesn't, a lot of people say, hey, look, we have a shape this way, like this animal, so we should be like this. But you say, look at the biggest animals, elephants, I think of the other big animals not right now, but...
Giraffe,
thank you.
Rhino?
Yeah, I was thinking, are they also...
Veggie, yes.
Plant-based, yeah.
Yes.
So it's amazing, you know, I think most of the... the monkey family, but sometimes they eat bugs. Bugs is another category of, in some areas are trying to make that as a protein source, like crickets. And,
okay, you know, sometimes, yes.
You know, ground it up.
As far as I know, sometimes chimpanzees, from time to time, fight to each other until death.
Yes.
And they eat,
yes.
The defeated chimpanzee, as far as I know. But I think it's more like a religious kind of stuff.
Phenomenon, yeah.
Yeah, I believe they are mainly plant-based.
Yeah.
Well, and sometimes they take
the bug out of the
hair.
Yeah. Yay, buddy, come here, I saw that. You have a grub in your hair, that looks amazing, yeah. So yeah, it's funny. So we can, to get a clue, you know, I think that just makes us all so interesting. We have such a variety of ways to get a sound nutritional, I like the concept of like having cleanses. So if you eat one way, let's say you do eat meat, take one every quarter, one time a year, or up to four times a year, and say, I'm going to have a X amount of time, 1 week, 1 month. They do it in Thailand. They have, I think, a week or a month where one part of a town is only plant-based, and they have a big festival. You would enjoy, actually. Well, we'll find it afterward. It's like a plant-a-thon, you know, no matter what, because they, you know, mostly they're not plant-based, but they know this is like some festival. I don't know if it's religious or not, but it's so interesting. You should take a break just to give your body a break. You know, it can affect your digestion, your state of mind. You might get, so I think the concept of a cleanse is missing. No matter the diet, the concept of like, take a break, you know, from whether you fast or you do smoothies or juices or you add spirulina or chlorella or just, you know, or a combination thereof, or intermittent fasting is very popular in the US. You just don't eat only in a short window of time, only have 4, 6, 7 hours, and that's the time to eat, you know. I tried that, I don't know, I don't find a big difference, but some people love that. They say that helps them tremendously. And plus your body type, you know, there's, you know, three types of body types, mesomorph, ectomorph, and mesoendo and ecto.
Ecto.
Yeah, which ties into the Ayurvedic three types of, you know, Ayurvedic medicine from India.
No, I am not familiar with the term.
Can I share with
yes.
Yeah.
Yep,
so just like China has Chinese medicine, and it's both, you know, people always say it's needles and massage and certain types of food. India does too. India has their own type of phenomenal, very dynamic type of eating, and with medicine, and it's called Ayurveda, like it's, I think it may be even older, just as old if not older than the Chinese method. And they talk about, you have three types of body styles. Like the Chinese have the five elements we mentioned a moment ago. The Indian Ayurvedic system has three elements, either Vata, Kapha, or Pitta, which represents similar to the five elements. So Vata would be the element of air. Kapha would be the element of earth. And the last one is Pitta, the element of fire. And this is represented in people. Like people who are Vata is more like me. It's like an air, thin. I'm normally, I have been thin my whole life. I have not been able to, you know, some people are not jealous of me, but I have not been able to gain weight. I must eat a lot of food. Whoa.
I told you this chair was,
yeah, I see it.
Was horrible.
Yeah, I can see that it's kind of bending in the back. You okay?
Yeah, I'm okay.
All right, don't fall over in the interview. That would be bad. To figure out how to do the camera myself and call a doctor for the doctor.
That would be hilarious.
Yeah. We'll talk about bloopers. Yeah.
it's really nice. I usually take a lot of tell jokes during during my speeches here on YouTube.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And I say silly things all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to throw one in or?
No. Well.
I'll finish and you throw.
Yes. Up. Yes.
The last. Okay. So then it'll be joke time. So the three elements. People have like a fire. People have a big temper. They'll be fiery. They'll be pitta. And if they're really heavy and sluggish, it's a kapha or a kapha energy. And usually it's a combination of one or more. So sometimes, like I had a student from a school of Ayurvedic medicine. They had one in California, in Grass Valley, called the School of Ayurveda. They did like a 30-page analysis and they over the phone, and she said, "Oh, you have primarily the energetics of vata, like 70%, which means you're a little more like air." And I think about it, my mind changes a lot, to be honest. So that's like an air thing. If you can bounce around, just like air bounces around, and the fire, you know, it's like it's like a fiery energy. And the kapha is the earth, and that's where I had the least. Most people have a combination, and they do it as a percentage of all three. The ideal is to have the balance of all three. But so you would eat basically from the Ayurvedic point of view, depending on your disposition, your another word for it, but it's basically once they determine the category you are, the combination of those three elements, then they'll prescribe food. Like a kapha person would not eat what a vata person would want. Like the person with a lot of air wants to have grounding food so they can be more grounded, but the kapha person should have more air so they're a little more energized.
Like bananas, apples, and
yeah, like as in, like as a vata person, I should probably eat more root vegetables like
radish, meat, potatoes,
mm-hmm.
Okay,
and certain herbs like ashwagandha is a very popular herb, and that it's a type of herb. It's also very focusing and calming. So there's no one size fits all. It just depends on who you are. Like if you like rock music, you shouldn't have to listen to classical. You know, like what's the So it really depends.
Well, I would like to read more about that, but if I fit into the category of the air.
Yeah.
So eating such as bananas and apples and so on. I mean, I love garlic. What's the thing with garlic and onion? I really, really love garlic so much.
Wow.
So I wouldn't be able to eat garlic on a regular basis if I were air.
Oh, I don't. To be honest, full disclosure, I don't know enough about it. I just know a few herbs and the basic concept. Recommend a proper Ayurvedic practitioner to give you. It'd be interesting, you know, just to get the diagnosis and see if without telling them the things you like, see if it matches up. Sometimes we're attracted to things that are good for us, and sometimes we're attracted to the things that are not good for us. That's kind of the double-edged sword.
I fully agree with you.
Yeah.
And even with people, we are sometimes attracted to the wrong girl.
Yes.
And I don't know why.
The opposites attract. Back to Chinese shamanism, they have the yin and the yang. You know, you have the polarity where sometimes you want someone that's going to be compatible with you, but sometimes there's the opposite. Like, oh, they're so interested. I like this, but they like that. I say hi, they say hello, and you're so fascinated. Like, how can they think and be that way? And it creates. Think of an actual physical magnet. If they're both plus, they'll repel.
Yes.
So in nature, sometimes some things are opposites. I'm sure there's some things but there's also like the concept of there's a concept called likes attract likes. Like if you're a high professional, that's more like a little art of attraction, if you've heard of that.
A little bit.
Yeah. When they say let's say you're a professional banker, and you're probably going to associate with other professional bankers. You're not going to hang out with a bum on the street doing drugs. Hopefully not. You know, that would be maybe a side your secret life, but you shouldn't do that anyways. So likes attract likes exists in nature. Also, opposites attract exists in magnets. Nature gives examples of things that almost don't make sense because they're how can this be true and that be true? But lightning is a very strong, powerful, fast force, but a rock with a little bit of a breeze is a very slow force. So there's a variety in nature, I guess you could say, and that all comes into like harmony and eating well and making a good life.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm thinking about what you are saying. I'm really thinking about it. But have you heard of Dr. Jordan B. Peterson from Toronto?
The psychologist?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. He's got very popular recently.
I don't agree with him in 100% of everything he says, but I agree with a lot of things that he says. I have his book somewhere here.
Oh, cool.
His latest book. Well, probably it's inside my car. I don't know, but it doesn't matter. But he said that it's better for relationships if you share your life with someone that shares your values and interests.
Yeah.
That's mainly what he claims, and I think he's right.
Yeah, I would think that would make most sense. Yeah. You know, something, especially if you're passionate about something, if you're interested in agriculture or something, you want to say, oh, look what I found, and, oh, that's so interesting, and you could have discussions, and it leads to a long, you know, if not a lifelong, ability to have some common discussion and activity.
But I would find very difficult to mix a bullfighter with a vegan, for instance.
Yeah. You know, but there's a famous couple, though. There's a famous couple. There's an older rap group called Run DMC. Oh, this is back. This is an expression I'm dating myself now, but this is back from the 80s. There was a group, three or four black guys, African American guys that are from. One of them became a vegan, but his wife was a full-on meat eater, and I guess they're still together, but they got along. They made it work.
I would like to know more about that story, but I find it very difficult.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'll make a note and I'll try to remember to show it to you. If you got a kick out of it. Yes.
Run
DMC.
DMC. Okay.
It's tricky. It's one of their songs. It's almost a little silly now when we look back at some of the music. They're great though.
I love the 80s.
Oh, okay.
But I like the awesome. Great Invasion.
The Brit
Tears for Fears,
yes.
OMD.
Oh yeah, amazing, amazing.
Depeche Mode, all that
yes,
stuff.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Those were the best.
The Cure.
Ah, yes. Yes, of course.
Speaking of health, yeah, we got it. Yeah, I never thought, I actually read a few blog posts. I try to think of something with a little bit of food and a little bit of like musical humor. I'm like, just thought of that now. The Cure, I never use that. It's like,
for instance, do you know Bryan Adams from Canada? I know
he's
from the States.
Yes, yes.
He's fully vegan, as far as I know.
Wow, no,
he's
at the.
I mean, he plays the guitar in such a way.
Yeah,
it's great.
Yeah. So is Bill Clinton. I don't know if he still is. He became vegan.
Yes, he is.
Yeah, and Moby. You know who Moby is?
I know.
Yeah.
He plays electronic music, I believe.
Yes.
Yes. And what about the? Paul McCartney.
Yes, I believe he is as well. There was a test. There was a blood of about 15 years ago. There was a popular test called Eat for your blood type, because we all have our three, four blood types. You know, A positive, O, A, B, whatever. I don't actually remember all of them. But there was a book that became popular. Have you heard of this?
Yes, a little bit. Yes.
If you're A, you should probably be plant based. If you're O, it's probably better. Actually, you have a history, your genetics was, you're better off not being plant-based. Even though some people are, and they are plant-based, but that had a little bit of popularity before paleo and keto and intermittent fasting. It had a little bit of time in the limelight.
I fully understand it's great to have to engage in this discussion about meat and plant-based and all that stuff. It's healthy that we discuss all this.
Yeah.
But I definitely know in my guts, junk food and the Western diet, like most of Americans and Mexicans have,
yes,
such as soft drinks and all that garbage, I mean, that's not healthy. Yeah. There's no question about
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, you have one of the factors that it affects is the pH of the body.
Yes.
You know, if we want to talk briefly about that.
Yes, yes.
That, you know, the pH is a scale between 0 and 14, and it's 7 is the middle, so it's neutral. So anything less than 7 is acidic. Anything between 7 and 14 is alkaline. Now the way it's measured, even though you hear we go 1, 2, 3, it's really back to math. It's a logarithmic scale, so it's a big jump. It's like it's not just 1, 2, 3. It's like they're very big jumps, but it's hard. You couldn't graph it because if you're going to go up 10 times every spot, you wouldn't have really space to see it. As you're talking a very large graph. But the body as works, like we take temperature, we take the pulse, we do certain readings in the as an MD. But one I've learned of is the pH is one of the body will work so hard to keep the pH in a certain range. It has to be between
7.35 to 7.45.
Yes, and it will do all kinds of things in your body to make sure it's in that, because you will die or you'll be really sick if you're not in that range. Again, it goes 0 to 14. If you're not 7.3 to 7.45 or so, which if you notice, it's a little bit on the alkaline side. If you're not a little bit alkaline, your body, it can actually, so your bone is made of, you know, we all know it's calcium, but it can actually, the word is leach. If you think of probably in a science fiction movie where they pull the energy out of the guy, like what was it, one of the movies where, you know, it actually can pull out the calcium out of the bones to use it in a kind of chemical reaction. Because it says, I need calcium to balance things out. So it will actually, that's why osteoporosis, you probably know more than I do, but a lot of conditions can occur because if you're too acidic, your body's like, we got to get you back in that range. And it will, that's why the junk food, of one of the many reasons it's so bad, because it will say, you're too far this way, we got to get you back that way. So sorry, buddy, you're going to lose some of the calcium out of your bones so we can make things right. And as you get older, you may not know, your bones are more brittle. You don't feel, hopefully you don't feel the calcium coming out of the bones, but it can reduce the integrity, I guess you could say, the bones, because instead of, you know, the 100% you should have, now you have 75% calcium, and you don't know, or an older person doesn't know until they fall and they easily break a bone.
Now that you took us to the pH, I gotta say, it's not a joke. It's a true story from the hospital.
Okay.
One of my colleagues, when I was doing my intern year in a public hospital in Guadalajara, I won't say his name because
privacy.
Yes. I won't
make up a name. No. Okay.
It doesn't matter. A friend of mine.
Some guy.
But you know that the pH of the arterial blood is between 7.35 to 7.45. So he took the sample from the arterial blood, and the result came after a few minutes, and the patient had a 7.2 on the pH scale. So our boss, I mean the chief of the department, told my friend, "Hey, run the test again. You are a dingleberry. You're a dumb doctor. Run the test again." So my friend said, "No, I really
took it
from the from the arterial blood, which is from here, and it's really painful."
Oh, really?
10 minutes later, the patient died. So my friend was correct. He took the sample from the arterial blood.
Yes.
And my professor was was wrong.
Wow. Yeah, that's a shame.
Yes, but
what could you have done now as a doctor? Now, I know, again, my certification is a 1-year program. I'm a health coach. I have 1 year of education, or you have many, many more. But I would think, you want to become, you to make, to get someone in one state or the other, like, you want to get acid real quick, you, meat is acidic, you can have junk food that could be acidic. But if you want to get alkaline, plants are alkaline, by the way, you could have baking soda. Do you think it would be wise to have...
Yes.
If that was your patient, you say you have 10 minutes, if you said you could have like a time machine, you got to get an alkaline quick, what could you do besides baking soda?
Nothing.
Really?
Yes, that patient is just about to die. You can fight.
It's unavoidable.
Yes.
Wow. See, folks, that's how important it is to be alkaline, which means back to having a lot of vegetables in your, a lot of plant-based food.
That patient was on, I don't know, like 25 drugs, and he had multiple diseases, so there was nothing to do
to
his patient, nothing.
Yeah.
But my friend was right on the money.
Yeah.
Even though
Well, it's an awful, it's an excellent, but it's both an awful example, but an excellent example of how important it is, because, you know, what I, if I can just summarize my feeling of, you know, because I've been studying nutrition, even though I went to school about 10 years ago, I always read books and watch things, and I'd like to kind of put it together and say, you know, what it is, when you eat, either whether you eat or you're living good or bad, it's a slow moving of a needle, kind of like a needle that says you're kind of in a healthy range, and it's slowly moving. So if you eat junk food, it may take 10 years or more to the conditions are so slow. Someone said a saying is something like, you usually go either to improved health or to the grave one bite at a time. It's very gradual, right? Unless you eat poison, actual strip, very high strength poison, you're going to be just slowly putting yourself one way or another direction.
Which, if I may, brings me to the next question. What do you think about adding fluoride to the water?
Yeah.
Do you think it's healthy to use fluoride in the toothpaste?
No, I mean it's unfortunate. I mean it's one of those, I don't say taboo, but it's one of those things that.
Do you think YouTube's gonna ban
video? No, you can find videos. In fact, I suggest look up effects on fluoride. Yeah, we're good, but. There's unfortunately a lot of taboo. There's a lot of false and misinformation. Unfortunately, I mean, I'm just, you know, most people won't tell you this. Your dentist will say no. Your dentist will say you need it, but you know, there's natural occurring substance that in water in some natural spring, which the word it sounds like fluoride. Now I have to research a little bit more, but there's. The fluoride you're talking about is the stuff that's in toothpaste and some food products. It's actually a chemical. This is an actual, you know, look it up. You know, you'd be like, this is where the shock is, really, to be honest. Because these are like, what do you mean? This is so common. But unfortunately, you know, life is full of surprises. I don't know how else to say it. You know, sometimes truth is stranger than fiction. So if you look it up, fluoride is a pacifier. Not, you know, a baby has a pacifier, you know. But this is it makes people more a pacifying personality. It affects the, I keep reading multiple places, you see it affects the pineal gland, which is a, you know.
Pineal gland?
Yeah, you see it actually calcifies it. And I'm basing this off what I've read in many places. This is kind of like, if you're in the know, if you're in the health community, most people say no, that fluoride, it calcifies the pineal gland, so. It's kind of like one guy said, "Can I swear? Can I have a one swear?"
Yes.
All right. So it's your bullshit detector. You know, when you people like know what's going on in the world, you can kind of glob. You can imagine glob it up. You can kind of coat it with something so people can't be as sharp, and it's easier to control people. Unfortunately, this is maybe a shock if you've not heard this before, but. Everything I've read is to say no fluoride. The same for aluminum, by the way, which is in a lot of deodorants and a lot of cookware.
Yeah.
So, anyway, back to fluoride. Yeah, so I absolutely think it's a bad idea. But don't confuse it. There's naturally occurring, and it may be fluorine. I still haven't figured it out. But naturally occurring clean spring water sometimes has fluorine, which is not the same as fluoride, which was off of a chemical process. I forgot the chemical process, but I think someone found, hey, look what this does. This makes Johnny over here a little dumber. Hey, let's put it in everybody's, you know, put it in the water and put it in the toothpaste, and let's see how it goes. And yeah, I'll try to remember to send you links. There was in Australia, I found recently, there was a news special where they had a water source and the city wanted to add fluoride to it. And some people knew that that's a bad idea and they're trying to fight it. And they said, you know, they said everything I said on the Australian news. They said the science shows it lowers IQ points by like 2 to 5 points. And I'm kind of guessing, but there's definite science behind it. There's
it's, you know, it's just, it's unfortunate because there's so much science saying it's bad, but it's still in the ADA, it's still in Crest and, you know, all those other brand names. So it's one of those weird things, like, how come it's bad, but it's still out there? Well, you know, you'd be the judge.
As far as I know, in Switzerland and Austria, they don't fluoride the water.
I heard
they
too.
Don't. So
here too, they don't, or do they?
No, they don't.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have another question. I wrote some of the questions.
Okay.
Let's see, because this is being very interesting. What's your opinion in regards to monosodium glutamate?
Oh yeah, yeah. Also, not a good thing. You know, this is the word. It's called an exciter. Somehow it excites certain neurons in the brain, and I think a Japanese guy created it. And we discussed this briefly, how it mimics one of the five senses. You know, umami is one of the five. You know, sweet, sour, bitter, salty.
Yeah.
And umami, it's supposed to mimic umami, according to Wikipedia. And it's very, very prevalent in Asian food. Living in San Francisco, I loved going to Chinatown to get Chinese food. Usually, they had a lot of vegetables. You know, we'd walk with the main, like a green broccoli would be your green, and your carrots would be yellow, and maybe some red peppers. It was very colorful. But they always added monosodium glutamate. I always have to ask them. Sometimes I had to say it in Chinese because they didn't speak English. You know, I have to figure out what version of Chinese they speak, whether it's Mandarin or Cantonese, and ask them, is it, do you put it in the food? And they say, yeah. I say, can you cook with that? And then they say, so definitely again, no. That's it's a neurotoxin. I myself, when I stayed in Asia for about a year and a half almost, to Thailand and Laos and Malaysia, and it was so prevalent, I always had to ask it, whatever language the country I was in, 70 to 90% of people use it. You know, and I mean, they do a lot of other health things, so I don't know, it probably affects them. I don't know what their lifespan is, but I'm sure it's not good. So, but it's, again, it's in the world of both that and fluoride, in the world of chemicals. I don't know of any chemical that is beneficial. I'm sure there are some maybe, but by and large, no, just say no.
I went through the FDA web page a few months ago, and they say it's safe.
Yeah.
In small doses.
Yeah, and I guess in fairness, you know, anything in small doses, you might not even know. Your body's like got an army, so to speak. So.
Yeah, even if I slap you in the face in small quantity, it would be healthy.
Yeah, there's a wonderful guy in Taiwan. He does this thing called slapping method. He slaps the meridians.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
Lai Lai Tai Jing.
I was just
name. Fooling
around with my camera.
Oh, I'll show you. I'll show you afterward. It's a great method. He's cured people with stroke and all by slapping because the body has 12 meridians.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I do know that sometimes the difference between drug and poison is in the quantity.
Yes,
I understand
this. Yeah.
But there are some exceptions, I believe.
Even water, if you have too much water, you have hyperhidrosis. You could, too much of it. Well, they say too much of a good thing now. You know, too much of anything can be
boring, also,
or problematic.
Yes. 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 That applies to everything, even relationships.
Yes.
Please tell us about your trip to India.
Oh, wow.
And
yeah.
East Asia.
Which one? I was in India twice.
Both?
Both. Okay, so one time I went over 20 years ago. I had a friend from India, and he's like, hey, you know, I know you like Indian. I was fascinated. I was working with a guy named Ravi, and he's a real nice guy. He invited me over, you know, him and his wife, maybe a little small child. He's like, you know, you want to come over? And I always liked foreign food. You know, my dad's from Israel, so I had a little taste. I went to Israel four times by the time I was 18. So that was pretty foreign.
Do you speak Hebrew?
Katzat, which means a little.
Shalom, Haverim.
Shalom. Oh yeah, very good.
I sang that song in a Protestant church ten years ago, which is silly because I am not Protestant, but what the hell.
That's cool. Yeah, I haven't heard that in a long time. Gosh. Yeah. But I was on foreign food, you know. So I went. I had foreign food in Israel, and then just growing up, you know, in the U.S., we have they say the melting pot. We have so many people from so many different ethnicities, and we're lucky. You know, even here too, you can get. One day you want Chinese, the next day you want Japanese, and later that day you can have Italian, and you can have French, and Indian seemed interesting. I found it when I went to university. There was Indian food, and it was so spicy and so much flavor, and things I'd never really known of. So I went to India, and first time was a little rough. You know, my friend said, do not eat in a restaurant. Do not stay with my family. Let them cook for you. Because he had to go back early, so I stayed longer than he did. So he says, you know, we came together, but he left before me. So he's like, just let my family take care of you. Do not eat any restaurant whatsoever. I said, okay, fine. But then two cousins, took me to a restaurant. And I figured, well, told me not to. But I guess they know what they're doing, because they would have taken me to a restaurant. No, so.
Yes.
I got really sick for many, many days. And in fact...
But why? Did they use a lot of oil or spicy food or what?
It's what they didn't use. It's a little thing called soap. I ate and I saw the guy, this is, I think he was doing the dishes. I saw a spigot for water, and he had a spoon with his fingers. And I'm thinking, this is how he's washing the spoon. And I ate, and I guess that would be called foreshadowing, like in a movie. Like, I don't think this is going to be good. So,
you got intoxicated. Staph aureus, probably, or who knows?
Something. It was bad. It was bad. And it was funny, it was in southern India, which interestingly is, they're all vegetarian, the entire city is vegetarian. And I wasn't, and now, lately, the last few weeks, I've been more. I kind of go through phases where I'm in and out, but I was like, everything was really spicy and hot, and I was sick, and I'm like, I just want something else, and it was really rough. Like I had like smuggle a chicken, like, you know, it was like really bad. So that was for the first time. Then I went back about 10 years ago because they have an interesting place for eyesight improvement. In southern India.
Eyesight?
Yes.
Myopia and so on?
Yes. It's one of the
astigmatism also?
Yes. It's one of the only places in the world where they'll actually train you and improve and help you with your eyesight almost for free.
There is an ophthalmologist from New York from the 19th century, Gates, you know?
Bates, perhaps?
Oh, sorry, it's Bates.
similar name. Different guy. Yes. It's based on his work.
Dr. So it works?
Yeah, well, it was an amazing experience where they had about 20 women helping you. They have almost like a station, so you go there. It is amazing. It's closed now because of all the dynamics, but you go there and they say, okay, you go here, and she puts some drops in your eyes. She says, okay, go look at the sun like this, and then you go in this room, and you have a candle, and you're reading a really small print, and it's an amazing place. I really, really recommend it.
Is that the Trataka treatment?
No, it's mostly based. What is it? Is that a machine?
An exercise with your extra orbital muscles.
Oh, wonderful. Wow, I'd like to hear more about that.
I am no expert. My teacher is an expert, but I am not.
Wow. All right. I'll have to write it down, please, for me after.
Yes.
Write it down, yeah.
And I will write it down
put
for
a
you
T for
in Spanish.
For
Spanish. It's yes, it's T R A T A K A.
Trataka. Cool. Sounds like Japanese. Trataka. Like a Japanese sword or something.
Like katana?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Hey, I know how to use a long sword.
Cool.
From the medieval times.
Oh, yeah.
I practice fencing.
Yeah.
Do you know historical European martial arts? I fence.
With two swords?
No, just one.
Oh,
okay. With one, with both, with my two hands.
With the hands.
I love it.
Cool. Well, I'd like to. Yeah, you got one around here. We'll have to.
Not here. Not here, but I don't want to kill someone.
Break one of your bookcases. Cool. Yeah, I like that stuff. And growing up, you know, in the 80s, we had a lot of martial arts movies, so we were always exposed to samurais and ninjas and you know, martial artists.
Yes, the Karate Kid and
yes,
anymore.
Yeah, yeah, all that stuff. Jackie Chan, Bruce Lee. So that's like mesmerizing. So cool. But anyway, back to India. So I went back and I wanted to go for the school. And then I noticed that when I was there, they have the, you know, what we call dingy, really small, like shanty, like look like the restaurants and the places were falling apart, you know, basically like barely holding together. But every place I went to I saw these tubes for water. And I said, oh, they have a reverse osmosis. You're familiar with that?
Yes.
Yeah. Everywhere, even the worst looking place had reverse osmosis. So, because the first trip too, the water was like from a well. The well was very big and it was cut open. And I'm like, man, I think like flies are falling in there and people throwing trash in there. And I'm like, I don't think that water's too clean. So the water was very clean and I took some chances and I ate the food in like the worst looking places after a recommendation from the woman at that school. And I was fine. I was so happy because the food. They do a lot of carbs, you know. Again, I didn't see much meat at all. It was still mostly vegetarian. They had a few stands like selling fish. And she's like, you should probably get fish once a week to get your protein up. But so much carbs. They love rice. I mean, it's like rice by itself, and then rice with spices, and rice with. They love milk, so rice with soured milk. They call it buttermilk. And it was really neat. I really enjoyed it. You know, mostly food is what I enjoyed. And they had a little beach there, and it was pretty cool. It used to be a French colony, it's called Pondicherry, so it was a French, well, you had a French influence as well.
Wow. I have a few more questions,
sure,
if I may.
Of course.
Why is it that, how can I say this, morbid obesity is so prevalent in the US?
Yeah, well, part of it is advertising. You know, we have a lot of people watching TV and there's a lot of commercials. And commercials usually, you know, advertise things that people want, what they want to interest people. Seduce maybe is even a strong word, but there's a kind of seduction in a way where there's commercial for like, you know, sports, and there'll be a commercial for deodorant or clothing, but also for food. Food is a big advertising part of. If you're watching TV, every 10 minutes you're gonna see, get the new XYZ burger from Burger King or McDonald's or something, and they show like they make it look like, you know, with a lot of cheese and a lot of meat and, you know, no vegetables, hardly, maybe a piece of lettuce. And a lot of things that are very, so one is the, we talked earlier about, you know, a plant, the benefit of a plant, or fully or even mostly plant-based diet, then it just kind of goes through you, and you just can't get big and fat on broccoli. You eat broccoli all day, 24 hours a day, you're not going to get, oh my God, he's looking at so much broccoli, maybe you'll turn green. And
400 pounds weight.
The broccolinator. Yeah.
Possible,
right. So, you know, a lot of it is.
So, do you think it's advertised due to advertisement? Heavy advertisement?
That's part of it. There's convenience. Like, if, you know, if you want a good meal, you have to go get the vegetables and you have to cook them, you know. But most people can go to, you can drive through, you know, McDonald's, Taco Bell.
May I make a small criticism to the American culture? I'm not trying to be disrespectful to the US. I actually admire you guys, especially the founding fathers and many other people, but I think at some point you guys lost yourselves, or you stopped believing in yourselves, because you guys don't cook anymore. You just buy everything in a can, everything in a refrigerator, refrigerated or freezed. Frozen. Frozen
or in a box.
Or in a box.
Those are the four categories. You know, frozen,
canned,
refrigerator, or in a box.
Or in a box. That's not food.
They don't know. They don't. You know. There's a saying. I'm not like a religious guy, but there's a saying like, my people perish because of lack of knowledge. That's
okay. Okay.
And plus, you know, so there's a lot of, you know, so it's, you know, it's a many factors. I mean, at least three factors. One is convenience food. Two, that they're driving. Most people drive in 90% of the U.S. They're not walking or exercising. But some people, you know, Jim's. I mean, I don't know if Jim drove right now, but Jim is a small business. So the sedentary lifestyle, the convenience of food, the lack of a knowledge of vegetables. And most, you know, kids, ooh, gross, a green vegetable. So as a young age, people say it's kind of icky. And then it's all back to what we said earlier, the word is altered. So much food is altered. Even vegetables and fruits are altered. They're either have pests. Now, here's a kind of segment example.
Yes.
Two groups of dogs, that's about 10 years ago, were fed the same identical diet. One had an organic version. One had a diet with pesticides. The group with the pesticides had about 10 or 15% higher body weight. The body does not, yeah. The thing most people don't realize, because it's a microscopic dynamic, the chemical products in the world, the body's like, oh, this is bad. I gotcha.
Shrink.
It encapsulates it. Oh,
I got it. Yeah.
And it doesn't excrete it unless you know and are doing things like a liver cleanse, a gallbladder flush, kidney cleanse. If you don't go through this way, cleansing is so important. If you don't go through the cleansing, your body will just kind of like hang on to it, but it ends up being like a closet full of junk.
You know, as far as I know, most of the fruits and vegetables from the U.S. have a lot of pesticides.
Yeah.
It's impossible to have two identical tomatoes. And I have been to the U.S. a number of times, Walmart and all that stuff, Costco, and I have seen the tomatoes. They have the same stripes and the same colors.
Tennis balls, yeah.
Come on. That's impossible. If you have grown tomatoes and lemons and so on, it is impossible to have absolutely identical tomatoes. 100 identical tomatoes, that's impossible. What are you doing with your countrymen? I mean, not you, but your country.
It's financial, you know. If someone says, hey, listen, we can got a farm and we can get 100 tomatoes in a week. And someone says, well, you know what? I can put it in the lab, or I can do something and I can get 200 tomatoes in a week, but it's going to have some kind of unnatural activity.
Who cares? I just want the money.
That's the name of that. And therein lies the problem. That's a partial answer. It's so much, and it's just so, you know, as we get, you know, and I don't even know how many methods there are. I mean, you've got to think, they started this maybe in the 60s, they are, sir, so over 60 years to improve this artificial Franken. There's I can recommend some documentaries if I may.
Yes?
Yeah.
Go on, please.
Yeah, there's a Fast Food Nation, Forks Over Knives, there's a one of my, I get chills I think about this one. This is a Crazy Sexy Cancer, Chris Carr. This explains real quick. There's a young lady, kind of like a socialite, you could say, a young lady living in New York, having a good time, and she's like 25, and she's, you know, well done. She's also, I guess, a documentary maker, or artist. So you see her calling on the phone, crying, "Dad, I need you to come up." And she has cancer. She gets cancer, and it's like some kind of incurable cancer. So they have her father and her and mother and with a doctor, and they're looking at the X-ray. You see, this is your liver, and she says, "See this black spot and that one and this one over here and this one and that one and this one. That's all cancer." So she's like, so she's freaking out. I mean, I don't know what they gave her to do, but it kind of like, you know, the expression "wake up call."
No.
A wake-up call, like, let's say you're smoking your whole life and someone says, you have a heart attack, and you say, okay, if you keep smoking, you're going to be dead in a month. and you say, I'm going to change my life around, that's a wake-up call.
Okay.
So, little sling. So she got the wake-up call. She says, so she made an excellent documentary about how she would, on a quest without knowing. It turns out, I think she was drinking that. Now, in the United States, aside from the food being problematic, you know, the vegetables and the fruit and the water being not just fluoride, but some of the other things, but the drinking alcohol, like vodka and all that, usually is a low quality. You know, the bar says, hey, a special night, 5 drinks for $1. It's a low quality, and it's also has some chemicals in it. And I think she said that's probably what she used to drink a lot, so it may have been a low quality vodka and rum might have caused, you know, because again, the body will just, it can't always get rid of it, it created the cancer. But whatever the reason she had cancer, she met on a quest, she had the wake-up call, and she went through 3 distinct types of holistic natural treatment. The first one was, one of them was a macrobiotic, actually, macrobiotic diet, and she learned a lot, it was very good. And the second one was, there's a guy in San Diego, he does a pH diet. And he just put it on a pH, like it's no, you know, you things that are high in alkalinity, low acidity or no acidity, and no mushrooms. And then she went to a third place in my home state of Florida called the Hippocrates Health Institute. Have you heard of it?
Yeah, no, but the name rings a bell.
Yes.
Because he is first, the father of medicine.
Yes, and his famous saying, you know, first,
Do no harm.
Yeah, but
no harm. Okay.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure it's probably translated, but yeah, first do no harm, which is so. It's a wonderful, about an hour north of where I grew up in West Palm Beach. There's a holistic. That's where that place is, and it's all raw experience. You stay there for about 3 weeks to a month. You eat nothing cooked. You have a lot of wheatgrass. I went there to visit a few times, and only raw juices. And then there's some kind of like therapeutic, like yoga and maybe some talking psychology therapeutics. And you know, after all 3 of those treatments, she was, you know, completely free of cancer. And she's now a wonderful spokesperson. She's been in Oprah and, you know, New York Times, and she has a book, and I never met her, but she's just she looks like a wonderful person, really vibrant, you know. And she always, you know, yeah, she used to have a photo on her website. She's sitting in like in a green truck with a green drink in her hand. Looks so cool.
What's her name again?
Chris Carr.
Both
with K's. So K-R-I-S, K-A-R-R. So I'll promote her website. Chris Carr, should I write down?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So
Carr?
Yeah. Chris Carr. Yeah, she's awesome. .com. But that's her name.
Carr.
Yeah, so she wrote, that's her name, and her documentary is Crazy Sexy Cancer. And just a great story, wonderful story. We're still on obesity, what we're talking about, or are we talking about shift gears? I know we got off track.
I lost track.
Yeah.
I think I asked you about the morbid obesity.
Yeah. Right, so
in the U.S.
Yeah, because there's so many things I think kind of altered, you know, so much food, there's lack of education, and then there's so much food that's, you know, on TV, like, do you really want to go to the store and buy broccoli and carrots and vegetables, and you need a right frying pan, and then make sure your frying pan is not Teflon and not aluminum, and it should be stainless steel or cast iron, and you have, okay, you're going to cook, you make sure you have a good oil. If you don't have you got the cheap oil, you may not know every oil has a different temperature threshold, so most people don't know they should use butter or coconut oil and maybe olive oil, but it's not as good. And then you may buy some cheap oil that's just full of chemicals too. So there's such a lack of education at so many levels that is part of the way people don't know how to cook, you know?
And you see, I happen to know how to cook quite well.
I imagine.
Which is very disappointing. I have not met a girl of my age or younger that cooks better than I.
Wow.
I haven't. And I know that sounds cocky or arrogant. I know that, but I'm daring you to show me that you know better than I how to cook.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I can make. But I can cook. Sorry. Lots of dishes from all around the world, even pizza from scratch.
You ever heard of the show Iron Chef?
No.
It was a series of, somehow had some popularity where they had some competition of who's the better chef. Okay, you have 1 hour to make this dish with these ingredients, and it's a French Asian fusion cuisine or whatever the rules was. And the judge, you know.
Iron chef.
Yeah. Maybe they have like a health version. You have to make a juice out of cactus leaf. And
it tastes quite well.
Yeah,
it's called
Nepal, yeah.
Tuna.
Tuna? Yeah, it's the round one. It's like a little.
The glycemic index is 7.
Yeah, what's the range again? From what is it going
from
to?
From 1 to 100.
Oh wow, great.
Rice has like an index of 85.
Wow.
So 7, it's nothing.
Yeah.
It's like water, just.
Yeah. I like avocado, and this is quite low. Avocado and jicama.
Oh yes, we tried jicama the other
day. Yeah,
quite. Right. It's great. You won't find it in the entire world, only in Mexico and southern United States, probably.
Yeah, yeah. In San Francisco, you can find it too.
Yes,
yeah.
I think where I first tried it. There is. I'm gonna make another critic to the US, if I may. I'm sorry.
Sure.
But when the Roman Empire invaded Greece. Let's say that the Greek culture was more interesting and appealing than the Roman Empire.
Uh-huh.
So that's why the Romans took the names of the gods of the Greeks.
Oh.
They took a lot of their culture. But I think at some point that's happening to the US and Mexico.
Mm.
Because, and I don't mean to be disrespectful for the Mexican cuisine, is better than the American gastronomy. So I think the American cuisine is switching into a more Mexican-like kitchen. The best-selling dish in during the Super Bowl is avocado, guacamole,
oh, yeah,
and chips,
mm-hmm,
tortilla chips. So that's why it is happening. You guys are assimilating the Mexican
food
kitchen.
Stealing your ideas, yeah. Well, we're an international country. I mean, we get, you know, there's influence from all over the world. I mean, yeah, definitely. Look at, you know, Mexican is extremely popular in the U.S. I don't think any major city does not have multiple Mexican restaurants or something like that. Some kind of influence.
We are also overloaded with American companies, such as
yes,
all these junk food chains.
Yes, I'm sorry for on behalf of my country. Yeah, there's not. Well, yeah, back to your question though. Really,
it's not your fault. We
no,
were
yeah,
dumb to accept that and go
yeah,
and buy our foods there.
I saw it in Colombia too. I saw in Colombia they used to have like fried places, you know. And I find places they just had like a small place that was not affected. It had like fresh fruit, like here, kind of fresh fruit juices and maybe fresh milk, or the food was like cooked properly. But they started to get more like chains, or like looked like it was like everything was fried and they only had soda. And I was like, oh God, this is horrible. So yeah, lots of changes, not always for the best, but.
I've never been to India, so I have to ask you this. Did you find a lot of obese people in Thailand and India?
I can't count. I don't remember hardly any. I mean, I think some people genetics, they're
tourists, maybe.
No, there might be some. There's some heavy. I remember this movie. There was like a heavy Chinese, because Chinese also thin because it's mostly vegetables, rice. And so if there's going to be meat, usually another idea on food diet is portion. Like if you have a plate, I was talking this years ago. If you have a plate, you can say this. You know, half the plate, a third of the plate could be vegetables and a quarter or a third could be carb. And if you're gonna do meat, have a small, have it like we have it. It's you can just have less of it. One of the terms I have for my website is I made up a called MOV, and MOV, my idea of this acronym would be mostly vegetarian, more vegetables,
like the term flexitarian.
Yeah, okay, that's another one. Yeah. Yeah, because some people just don't want to go that way. You know, some people, and again, you know, there's one lady I heard, she was vegan for years and years and years, and I actually think she got sick, and then she had some liver for, I mean, maybe one time in a couple years she would have it, and it just somehow her body, it seemed to work for her. So you can sometimes how much you have, how often you have it. So sometimes you can just have a smaller portion of something, and the rest of your plate can be, so you don't have to completely go 100%. You know, you can do it. I know you know how to do it because you have the interest and the black background, but some people, they're just, no way, they're not going to miss a barbecue or something, you know. So, all right, you've got to find the balance. You have to find a way to live your life that you're happy with and hopefully healthy.
Okay. I'm thinking about the other questions that I wanted to ask you. Oh, also, this is a very good question. Do you think indigenous communities are healthier than the average American lifestyle?
Yeah, again, this is a book I learned in my school. I'm going to refer to it again. It's Weston Price's. Weston A. Price was a dentist. Did I tell you about him already?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, please share this information with them.
This is great. This guy, thank God for my school. You know, it's Weston Price. So he is a Weston A. Price. First name is Weston. And he was a dentist about 100 years ago, and he retired, and he says, you know, I think I need to see this. He doesn't understand some of the dynamics never taught him in school, like some people's jaws, like what some people would have, sometimes people's cavities would reverse. They come in, you know, and his colleagues didn't really have an explanation, and they just pretty much encouraged him to not pay attention to it. They said, well, just don't worry about it, it's kind of a weird thing. But no, he wanted to figure it out. So he retired, whatever age, whatever year, and he said, I'm going to go find, I think he had a suspicion, he goes, I think in a different part of the country, of the world, we're going to find different people with a different type of eating, and they're going to be affecting their body. Because back then, there wasn't correlation. So he would go, and he found indigenous communities. They didn't have a doctor, they didn't have dentists, they would just, like I said, they would grow, eat whatever, they would grow food to eat, and if they needed the meat, they would go hunt an animal.
But not every day, just now and then.
I don't know the frequency, but the fact in general would be a diet that was, you know, they didn't have airplanes to fly in bananas from Peru.
Yeah.
So everything was around them, so they knew like this herb is poisonous and this one is good for tea, and somehow they made a diet and they knew this would be, they had very wonderful bodies and teeth. Their jaw was a little wider to allow the space for the teeth. They all had all of their wisdom teeth.
Yes.
And if they didn't eat, they ate the organs, they ate everything. And one category of the food that we don't talk about in most countries is fermented food. You're familiar with, I'm sure, fermented food?
A little bit, yes.
Yeah. So like Germany, sauerkraut. In Korea, it's a kimchi.
Sauerkraut.
Well, yes, that one, sauerkraut.
it sounds, accent. Everything in German sounds powerful and strong and...
Okay, yeah.
Like you're badass.
Okay, badass sauerkraut. So, so he says, yeah. So he went around the world. He found this is right before I think the what we call the Industrial Revolution, right, where there were still pockets of indigenous people, and even Western people that in Europe, but all the indigenous communities, you could see a big difference if they grew up and they, you know, they had their history. They had found a way to eat in harmony with nature. And they had wonderful health, vibrant health. And even some European communities that, you know, before they had roads and hospitals, this is what you call untouched civilization. There's one in Switzerland, there's a, it starts with an L, I'm gonna say it probably wrong, but Lofenschwal, I'm guessing, but it's kind of with an L and a long, but it was somewhere in Switzerland where they were a group, as I remember, they were a religious group, so they only ate, they ate vegetarian 6 days a week, and only the seventh day they would have meat. And they didn't have any doctors and dentists, and every like only 0.1% dental problems. So now back to the indigenous. When the indigenous communities, like in Aborigines in Australia, when they would go to live with the other, with the white people at the time, they would have some things, usually mostly sugar and bleached flour. Most flour is bleached. They actually remove things so it can last. Because most of, if you make bread, it's not going to last more than a day or so. You have to alter. Again, altering has some positive. It will stay on the shelf longer or in the cupboard longer, but the quality, the nutrients are removed. And they showed a lot of them had messed up teeth. You know, they may have the
cavities.
White drug. If they had cavities and they're missing a lot of teeth. So. Yeah, so I definitely recommend looking into his website or his book, Weston Price, and just for those photos to see, you know, he had them pull their gums back so you could see other teeth, and you can see like the broad jaw and well-formed teeth of the indigenous people.
Yes, yeah, yes, they have, some of them have very beautiful teeth.
Yeah.
Like, for instance, the Africans, have very, very beautiful teeth.
Yeah.
As a contrast to, I have a cynical sense of humor, but as a contrast to the British.
Yes. Because they're, from what I hear.
I make fun of everybody. Don't you take it personal. I make fun of myself also. So.
Same here, yeah. I have plenty to make fun of myself, so don't worry. Right, the British, I've heard, you know, there's they eat a lot of like those same categories, scones and, you know, meat pies and not a lot of vegetables. And I haven't been there, so I'm going by what I've heard. But yeah, if you have like, it's basically, I always think like this, if you have a lot of this and not a lot of that, you're creating a formula in your life. If you have a lot of sweets and pastries and not a lot of vegetables, and you're going to be developed one way, versus if it's the opposite, if you have a lot of, you know, food grown out of the ground and a lot of clean water, and you don't have a lot of junk food, you're going to develop in a different way. Even they show the nasal cavities is more room for air, that even the thickness of the skull, they have in the book, I'll show you if you want, they found like man from 100 years ago, like, and then 1,000 years ago, and then like 5,000 years ago, it showed how thick they showed it, because they only had a full skull, and then they had a piece of a skull and a piece of another skull, and they showed them on top of each other. The top one was the oldest, and it was really thick. Maybe they just got hit in the head a lot, I don't know.
did you watch the documentary The Game Changer? Game Changers? Or something?
I've heard of it. It's on my list. Yeah, I know. I know. I have no of it. What the Health, I think I saw. But I've heard of Game Changers. I haven't seen it yet.
It's on Netflix.
Yeah.
It's
okay.
Also very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's. I have one or two more questions.
Sure. One more documentary, if I may, is a reboot. Joe Cross, an Australian guy who was real heavy. Reboot with Joe is his website. Fat, Sick, and Nearly Dead. That's it. Gosh.
It's free on YouTube.
Oh, okay.
In Spanish.
Oh, cool. That's great, yeah.
Probably in English,
yeah.
It is not. But
you
Spanish.
Can find it. You can find it, you know. If you know where to look, you know. That's wonderful.
A patient of mine who has end-stage kidney disease recommended me this documentary.
Oh.
He's doing great with
his
treatment with me.
Good.
I mean, not great, it would be an exaggeration. He's doing okay.
Good.
He has a life.
Yes, that's, a good start.
Because there's no way to 100% cure the kidney when they are in the end stage.
Oh, really?
That's my point of view.
Okay.
But they can improve.
Yeah.
And that's something. He now rides the bike. He kisses his wife, which is something.
Good, sure she appreciates that.
Yeah, but he recommended me this documentary.
Yeah, have you seen it?
Yes.
Yeah, it's good, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Very good.
Someone in that documentary went to my school. One of the guys, I think the big guy named Phil, the big truck driver.
Yes.
Yeah, he went through my school and program.
Wow.
And you know, Super Size Me?
Yes.
His girlfriend went to my school.
Really?
Yeah, it's a cool school. It's not that popular now. I think a lot of schools came up with copy the model because you could do it online. You know, anyone can copy anything online. So I think there's a lot of other schools now. But yeah, there's a lot of schools. I mean, a lot of the people who graduated from my school, I've someone I mentioned earlier told me about the hair test.
Well, someone told me that the most flattering thing someone can make to you is copying you.
Yeah, yeah. Flattery is the sincerest form of imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. I've heard that.
This let's say show or whatever you want to name it has been someone tried to replicate it to copy it.
Okay.
It doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah, sure.
They can try, but it would never be the same. It would never be the same.
There's always room for.
They don't know my jokes.
Or your intro music.
Ah, my music?
The intro music. The.
Oh yes, the
William Tell.
William Tell.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that they can get.
But yeah, but
so good. You chose it. You're the first.
Yeah, the overture, but for this specific channel, I use Il Maestro Ennio Morricone, who passed away 1 month ago.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
He is the best. Even John Williams admires, you know John Williams?
I've heard the name.
He composed the music for Star Wars.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
He has won the Oscar, I know, like 10 times or more.
Wow.
Really, he's the best. But even he admires Ennio Morricone.
Cool.
So, I mean, he's really something else.
Ooh, wow.
Well, that's silly, but...
Yeah, no, it's good. Yeah. Well, it's a good sign. You're getting imitated. It means, you know, people are watching and they want to, you know,
be
a good role model.
I am into all this food and nutrition, but my real passion is music.
Oh, wow.
Really,
you're a doctor who really, you're a music aficionado who happens to be a doctor.
As a hobby.
Is that a hobby?
Yeah.
Which one's the hobby?
Doctor.
The doctor's hobby. Okay.
Yeah. Music is,
your passion, yeah.
Yes, that's me, 100%.
Okay. We'll have to hear some. I'll have to hear some afterward. I'll have to get some. I've already been inspired. You told me that one guy, the one you just said.
Yeah. Oh, when I went to. If they are bothered by this, change the video and the channel. Doesn't matter. But I went to live there at work at the AKH, which is the biggest hospital in Vienna.
Okay.
I booked the two seats for the opera.
Wow.
In advance for 6 months.
Wow.
Carmen. I mean,
it's
really
famous.
My passion.
Wow.
Well,
cool.
I think we are done with this. Are you tired? Yes.
I'm good, yeah. I love talking about this. I love this, like, you know, there's things that go on right in front of us. Like if I ask someone, you know what a spleen is? And they go, yeah. Do you know where it is in your body? Yeah, see, I think like we walk around with a mystery. 24/7. I mean, you know, you might feel your heart if you're nervous, you know, but you don't feel your hair growing, you don't know where your liver is, maybe you feel your lungs, but...
My liver?
Liver. Where'd I put my liver? Honey, have you seen my my spleen or my intestines? You know, but we don't know what's going on inside of us. All of the, like, another world, it's like a world going on, especially for health. Like, if everything's fine, you know, people are more concerned about, like, plastic surgery, you know, are my eyebrows right? Nothing wrong with that, but there's so much attention on the exterior, but if you put 10% of that on the interior, like, especially, like, do I need to do something? Like, most people don't realize you can do something for a part of your body's health. That's why, like, you know, there's cleanses for a specific organ. I mean, there's exercises, like the Chinese have, like, Qigong, there's exercises for stress or for your lungs or, and it's just amazing how it all connects. Like your left, I don't know, maybe like your left pinky toe may connect with your right shoulder or something. Just, there's so much that goes on, not just on the surface.
Yes, yeah. Acupuncturists know this very well.
Amazing.
Have you heard of iridology?
Yes.
In the iris?
Yeah. Yeah, I know a little bit about it. That's one of the many things
I studied with Dr. Jensen's daughter-in-law, Ellen Tartt Jensen.
Wow!
Yeah, 4 years ago.
I used to have his book. I used to have Dr. Jensen's book. I forget the name. It's a little book.
Yeah, but
Back to Health or something.
There are a lot of books.
Yeah.
But I studied with her 4 years ago.
Oh, cool.
Ellen Tartt Jensen. Dr. Ellen Tartt Jensen.
Sorry. Oh, we should talk about Dr. Morse. Dr. Morse is a naturopath. He's mostly the fruit. He's an ND in Naples, Florida. He prescribes mostly fruit for people, fruit and herbs.
Okay.
Yeah, he's. I think he's pretty brilliant. A filmman from my graduating class shared his work, and he's got a lot of YouTube videos, and he talks about. We'll have to watch. I don't know if I can even do it justice. He talks about how the body works and kidneys, and he says like most people don't realize, you know, you have to clean out your kidneys. Just like you wouldn't think of owning a house and never cleaning a house. You would think that's kind of gross, but with the body, they don't realize you have a kind of a obligation. Well, the body can accumulate stuff just like a house can accumulate stuff or a car or anything, and it can get dirty. But most people don't realize that. It's not on TV. It's not between the McDonald's and the Super Bowl commercials. So most people don't know. Well, or maybe even the doctors will say, oh, that's silly, you know. Sometimes they actually say, don't worry about it. But yeah, there's a cleaning, there's a way to, there's something I guess you should do to your body. You can call cleaning or detox or maintenance or eat this, don't eat that. But it's amazing. It's just the difference you can make by doing a few simple things.
Or treat your body as if you were in charge of taking care of someone else. Because if you have to take care of your pet, for instance, you give them the pill on a regular basis every day for 30 days, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have to take the pill, people forget about it.
Yeah.
Actually, Jordan Peterson says that take care of your body as if it were a body of someone else and you have to take care of him.
Oh, cool.
And he's right. I believe he's right.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
Cool.
Well, anything else you want to share with us?
Oh gosh, no.
A story from one of your patients, probably.
Oh, let's see. I've taken a little break, so I've been traveling a bit, so I don't have any right now, actually. Not too many right now, as a matter of fact, but...
You can speak, tell us about gold and silver investments and sort of things we talked other day.
Well, that's a whole nother story for peace of mind. I think you can find on my website. If I can just share my website again, I have some products. They're really just actually like this one. I don't know if I showed you this one. Did I even show you this?
Yeah. Broccoli.
Yeah. So I have some products like this hat. It's broccoli fists, and that's like a logo I had some help creating, and a little. There's like similar things like that on my site don't be afraid to try things. You know, I've gotten. I work with my dad a lot. My dad and I work together, and he's able to. Lower some of his medications. He's had some health issues working with flooring for 4 decades, and they wanted to get him on a lot of medications, and he was dizzy, and I sent him a lot of things. I had him do some activities. I had him go out and move. You have to keep moving. And so the idea is to find. I had him do a hair test to find out all of his levels of his calcium and sodium and magnesium. So it's like you need a team, and the team is me plus the things I've researched, and maybe sometimes I have to send him to a specialist. Sometimes you need to go to an acupuncturist plus a chiropractor plus take the pills, and of course don't do this and don't do that. So sometimes it's a group effort. I find it. Sometimes you have to find whether it's just the one thing you do, or you may need to combine it with, because we're all body, mind, and spirit. It's not just the physical body. If you have a perfect diet, but you're stressed, you had some trauma, you know, that also, they said the cell in the body, the cell is like, it's like a hard drive of a computer. It can hold a memory. So you have to make sure you're good on all levels. So you make sure you like meditate and you do things that are kind of not, some people just focus, I see this in yourself. They say, I eat perfect, I eat this and this and this, but I'm thinking, what about the emotional stuff? Did something happen to you maybe as a child? I mean, it's hard, you know, those kind of things. So if you can get it from all the right angles and you have also current lifetime, like you have a support group and you have family and friends, and like when I work with my dad a lot, I'll make sure I tell him jokes, I'll ask him about his life. I won't say, Dad, did you do this? Why don't you eat more vegetables? Why don't you drink enough water? Because I used to, and I say, no, Eric, I gotta stop. I say, how do you feel today? What makes you happy? You know, and I let him just talk, and I know we would call that in school medicine. We would say, you let someone be themselves, because, you know, it actually makes me a little sad. Sometimes people are so controlled, and they're always used to, like, my dad was in the army, so a lot of times it's the kind of, you do this and you do that, and they're used to that, and it's sad. They never get to express who they really are, or they think it's wrong to do so. And it's sad in a way, but it's lovely when you let them.
If I may add to your comment, because I fully agree.
Yeah.
But I think in the Western countries we were raised, we men were raised to only express one feeling, anger, nothing else. If you feel sad, if you feel like you want to cry, you cannot do it. You're not allowed because you are a man. You can only get angry. If you're sad, be angry. If you're angry, be angry. If you want to mourn somebody because they passed away, be angry. Don't you feel that's pretty much...
Yeah, mostly. I think if it does happen, it comes out and people just know. It's not... It's like if you just if you're with a buddy and someone dies, let's just say a bad example, and you start crying, that person will know. In that moment, they know, okay, it's okay for you to cry. They could just say, hey man, stop crying, but sometimes it you can't help but express, and that's very natural, and it's important maybe to be like, I think of a bar, like people go to the bar and they say, oh, you know, my girlfriend left me, or something, and they say, you know, the bartender has a special job. He's not just standing there washing the cup. He's also a therapist and the barber too. You know, I don't know how it is here.
Oh yes, yeah.
You know, they know it's unofficial. Like it's okay in the bar. It's okay in the barber shop. It's okay maybe if you're with your buddies, but it's not like written in a book. It's just somehow some guys, do get that type of allowance or that kind of. But it's not like it's almost like a. Don't tell anybody. Don't tell when I cried, right? You know, maybe movies you get that a little bit, but yeah, there's a website I follow. There's a guy. He's a lawyer. And he grew a little beard. He started a little funny. It's a little funny thing, but he had this website called Art of Manliness.
Art of Manliness.
Yeah, you know, I don't know if it's an adjective or adverb or whatever the gerund or noun, but. You know, manliness, happiness, sadness, manliness, like tells you, like how to tie a tie, you know, and how to choose the right shoes with, you know, how to
be a man,
how to chop down a tree,
or how to be a gentleman.
Yes. Yeah. Cause it's not, cause a lot of that, you know, I mean, this could be another, without getting too deep into it, but a lot of people come from a family where the father is not around or. They spend the time between the father and the mother, or they're divorced or whatever. And they don't really get a clear, the beautiful thing about the United States, we have such a mix, but the bad thing also, we have such a mix, people don't get a clear message on how to be whether you're a guy or a girl, or, you know, a kid or an adult, there's no, like, rule, or there's not much chance, like, well, what do you think is the best? That's what I learned in my school, is that it's not so much you tell them what to do, they said, you give them the opportunity to let their own wisdom come out. Better sometimes to say, and it's harder, you say, what do you think is the best thing to do? It's a strange thing, I have to remember, but it's the greatest thing I learned from that school. Because most people know what the right thing to do is. Like, if they're smoking, what do you think the right thing to do is? Well, I think I shouldn't smoke. Oh, how do you think you could do that?
So basically, it's just the Socratic method.
Oh,
asking
I never
questions.
Thought of that. Yeah, that's
Socrates
wonderful.
Socrates in the
that's
ancient
wonderful, yeah.
Greece said
yes.
This. It's nothing new. It's
yeah.
Just basically
yeah.
Socrates.
But there's a lot of inclination, especially for parents, to say, I want you to be a this, or, you know, there's a lot of...
Good for you. I want to be what I want to be.
Yeah, not... Yeah, yeah. So that's... It's better, I think, to have the open discussion, like you said, Socratic method, or... But it takes a little more work. You have to be patient. You have to bite your tongue. Maybe you feel like, I want to tell them what to do, but you have to resist that and just... My teacher says, most of my job is really to sit, ask questions, and breathe. Because he wanted to tell them what to do. Oh, you should do this, and have an apple, and juice, but let them talk. Because maybe they'll start telling you something about when they were 10. And that's the problem. It's not that they're not eating enough apples, it's the fact that they're angry at their mother for 10 years, because she locked, you know, she did horrible things. So a lot of it is this not obvious. It's the, I don't know the exact word, but... So
blurred,
or you know, you have to uncover the right box. So maybe kind of to wrap it up is
like you told me the other day, the analogy of the onion.
Yes, exactly. Very good analogy in healing.
Layer by layer.
Layer by layer. And they're all sometimes a little different. You might eat healthy and you might feel sick for a while because your body's like, finally, I can get rid of that junk from 10 years ago. Sorry, it's not going to feel good, but you've had it for 10 years and you're going to get a headache and feel tired and diarrhea and bad breath. And then you're going to talk about your mother. You know, I'm going to be mad. I never, for 10 years, I was so mad at her. And the anger might have affected your organs. You know, the Chinese say, if you're angry,
yes.
The liver. So it's such an interesting, complicated, and eventually it becomes simple, but giving people space to be who they are, to... You know, to really say, you know, you're a good person and you can be whoever you want to be. Most people, I don't think many people get that. I don't think most people get that type of permission. School is like, sit down, you want to go to the bathroom, you go to the bathroom when I tell you to go to the bathroom. So to say, someone say, it's like a crazy idea to say, oh, I can do what I want, I can work the way I want. It's, and sometimes actually diseases can go away in addition to food and the right eating, of course, but sometimes that part of the onion is in the dialogue.
Okay. Oh, this has been an extensive interview, but thank you. I appreciate that you are coming over to the clinic to make this interview.
Anytime. I flew all the way here from the United States to sit for this, so I'm happy to do it. All right, I was here already, but I would have. I'm
probably
very honored. Yeah, very honored.
We were good by the telephone. You
yeah, that's true. It's not that far. It's only a couple hours, but yeah, no, I'm grateful. I'm very grateful you invite me to do this. You know.
Hopefully, some of my let's say countrymen or the Spanish speaking community. In San Francisco, in the valley, like you say?
The Bay Area, really. The Bay Area.
Sorry.
Yeah. It's okay, you're close, you're really close.
Oops. Well, at least
probably.
I didn't say China. That's
China
far
town.
Away.
Yeah. We're all countrymen, right? One way or another. We're all brothers and sisters in arms.
Yeah. But if they watch this video, they probably can go into your website and find you and ask you for an assessment or whatever.
Sure, yeah, I think I have. I'm on most of the major social media outlets, you know, everything, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, everything is /nutritionbyeric, no spaces, dashes, or anything. And yeah, you can find me there.
Okay, so we are going to end this interview now. So would you like to say goodbye with me? In German? Just
sure.
Just try to say this word. Because okay. I always say goodbye, I say this word, which means goodbye in German.
All right.
Just because I like it.
Yes, I know, yeah,
you're
a fan.
Yeah. Oh, we can say it in Hebrew, if you can teach me how to
say
goodbye.
Oh yeah, we can do both. How about that?
Even better.
Okay, you want to do the German first?
Yes, so I'll see you. Stay tuned for our next episode. Tschüss!
Tschüss! And in Hebrew, it would be Lehitrot.
Lehitrot.
Yes. Lehitrot.
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 Yes, perfect. Yofi, if they mode. Very good.
So, Lehitrot.
And choose. Lehitrot and choose.
And choose.